Hello to all my collectibles investor friends. I hope everybody is having a great day today. I'm excited to come to you, talk about just kind of collectibles investing as a whole, and kind of my journey with it and just my thoughts on investing in collectibles in the year 2020. It's an interesting time. It's definitely a strange time for sure, just with COVID, with everything going on in the country. It's I don't really know what to make of it. But it's, you know, in conjunction, I think, for me with the fact that I'm going to be turning 40 next year, and my wife would agree, there's probably a midlife crisis element to my foray into investing in collectibles. And so, you know, it's something that I wanted to kind of dig a little deeper into because, you know, nostalgia certainly plays a huge role, I think, with all of us with some of this stuff. And so it's definitely driven, you know, my foray back into my interest back into sports card investing and in comic book investing. And a lot of it is that, you know, I think back to my own personal journey during my childhood. A lot of my best memories are trading cards with my buddies. And the same with comic books. There was, you know, a big boom in both sports cards and comic books in the late 80s and early 90s. And, you know, it just kind of went from there. And I just have a lot of really fond memories of that. And so I think over the last couple of years, it's brought me back to that, you know, to where it was one of these things that I was really excited about as a child. And then I've got little ones that are getting older as well and starting to get into things, you know, and so it just really drove that for me. And I think that a lot of my viewership can relate to it, although I do know that I have a lot of younger viewers, which I think is amazing. That there's, you know, high schoolers, college kids, you know, and 20 somethings that have really gotten into this. So it definitely tells me that it's got longevity, it's got legs, whether we're talking about sports card investing or comic book investing, or any other type of collectible that you're interested in. I know there's people that are investing in rare video games. I've even seen graded video games. There's all sorts of things out there, which it really intrigues me, and I don't pass judgment on it because even if it's not something that I'm into, you know, these are things that matter to people and they have, you know, intrinsic value to them, both monetarily, but also there's just something inside that, you know, it makes them happy. And I think in the end of the day, we're all just trying to be happy, you know, and so I've spent a long time, you know, just trying to kind of follow the basic financial plan that's been laid out to me by my parents, whether that's stocks, bonds, real estate. And I do have holdings in those as well. But I think that there is definitely room for collectibles investing. And I think there should be, frankly, if there is something that appeals to you that is worthwhile. I'm not saying that everybody should have some sort of collectible that they're investing in. Some people just never got into it, and that's perfectly fine. But I don't think that we should necessarily hide behind, you know, investing in sports cards nowadays, especially, you know, with the fact that, you know, sports cards have been around for 150 years, comic books 100 years. These are established markets, and that's something that's really important to me is, you know, if it's a collectible that I'm interested in, I would love and I'm passionate about, if I'm going to put a ton of money into it, you know, speculate on it, is it an established market or, you know, am I okay with the risk of something that's newer that may never become established? Back when I was a kid, and for people that are my age or around my age, Beanie Babies and Pogs were huge, okay? And Beanie Babies, I saw a meme the other day that was hilarious, and it was, you know, how divorces were going, you know, back in the late 90s, mid to late 90s, and it's two people in a courtroom, and there's a huge mound of Beanie Babies that they're separating up. And that pretty much tells the story of Beanie Babies. Although, I will tell you, and the same goes with Pogs, there are some valuable Beanie Babies and valuable Pogs out there still. There's one that, on the Beanie Babies side, I did a little bit of research. I think it's Cosmopolitan had an article that shows a Steg Beanie Baby. Of course, it's got to have its tag and everything, but selling for $50,000. And there's a few of them that are in that range. That are in that $50,000 range. There's no, I didn't see any $1 million Beanie Babies, but it just shows you that there is still some demand. There are still some people out there, you know, that are hunting for those sorts of things. So the demand might not be, of course, what it was in the 90s, But you know, and a lot of people lost their shirt on all sorts of, you know, different Beanie Baby buys. But you know, again though, it's something you speculate on it. Maybe you think that Beanie Babies are going to be the next, you know, comic book, sports cards, stamps, rare coins. You know, maybe that you think that's what it's going to turn into. So you speculate on it and you win or lose based on the outcome. Pogs are another example. I don't know if anyone was around in the 90s that played with Pogs and Slammers. But again, those are, you know, I could see people going back and buying those at around my age just because of the fun that they had with them and maybe get their kids into it. There are still some valuable Pogs. And actually, again, the internet showed me that there is a Jurassic Park card set. I'm putting up a slide so you can see that's either sold or selling for $1 million. I believe it was sold for $1 million, and it's a like cool holographic Jurassic Park Pog set. You know, so it must be a one of one, or it must be very rare to be commanding $1 million. But that just shows you that there are some outliers out there to where, you know, there's some expensive stuff. There's also different Pokemon, you know, Pogs that are very popular. So, you know, I mean, it's all what you're into, and then it's just a matter of figuring out is there investment potential or not. And of course, just like with anything else, there's risk attached to it. When you put money in the stock market, sure, it's considered a safer, you know, type investment, but it really depends on what type of stocks you're going after. If you're throwing money at penny stocks, you may as well be throwing money at anything because you just never know, you know, what's going to happen with those companies and even very established companies. You look at, you know, mortgage companies that have gone down, banks, Lehman Brothers went out of business. I mean, there's a ton of companies that had, you know, excellent stock prices that have fallen apart over the years. So, I don't think that you should feel bad about putting some of your resources into investing in collectibles. I think that you should just, you know, it's all about being happy. We have to be excited to get up in the morning and to get through our day, especially through these really tough times that we're going through. People are really suffering right now. And so if you do have disposable income and you have kind of set up a financial plan, but you're looking for something that, you know, to get into that could be fun for a change. And now, granted, some people really enjoy investigating companies and buying individual stocks. So that might be their fun investment, and that's perfectly fine. Same goes with real estate. A lot of people really, really, really enjoy real estate. They like going and looking at properties. They like the having rental properties. They like those types of investments, REITs and so forth. Totally good. Totally get it. And some people were, you know, never into any of these types of collectibles things, but you know, there are huge potential in collectibles in the same way there is with anything else. You know, in 1986, Fleer basketball is a great example where literally the dealers were trying to give that stuff away when it first came out. And now, I mean, and I saw a video on this, the value over time for 86 Fleer basketball compared to what it was selling for retail is like 1,000,000%. You know, it's like if you had put money into that, you would be Jeff Bezos right now type thing. You know, it's one of those things where nobody knew it was going to happen. If you were to be able to, you know, speculate on it, if you had the sports almanac from Back to the Future and you could have gone, you know, checked out what was going to happen with all this stuff, then maybe, you know, you make a solid buy there. Obviously, nobody knows what's going to happen, but I guess my main point is, for me, I need to have some fun while investing. It can't always just be, you know, pumping money into an IRA or, you know, into a, you know, some sort of portfolio. It needs to, that for me, there needs to be, you know, something that's fun that I like to look at. And I like personal finance topics in general. I like investing in general. And so it's all about finding the fun. And for me lately, the fun has been in sports card investing, not just because of the wild boom. I got into it 2 years ago before prices really started to come back, soar over the last, you know, I would say that's happened the last 9 months, 9, 10 months. That's really taken off. But, you know, it's fun for me as kind of a sports addict, you know, to think about who's going to be the next LeBron James, who's going to be the next Derek Jeter, who's going to be the next Tom Brady. And some of you are going to say there is no next Tom Brady. And I don't believe that because Drew Brees, my friends, is coming back. We're going to roll through these next couple of years. Everyone's talking about retirement. I think he adds two more championships to his belt over the next 2 years. You heard it here first. Hot take. Drew Brees is going to be in that GOAT conversation when we're all done with this thing. So Nah, I'm kidding, sort of kidding, hopeful, but I think it's probably fairly unrealistic. But anyway, who dat? So, you know, that sort of stuff is fun for me. Comic book investing, also fun. I like the fact that, you know, you can kind of speculate on movies and shows, and those are more long-term investments for me, just because, you know, there are flipping opportunities, but I just think it's cool to have first appearance of Silver Surfer, first appearance of Wolverine. You know, those are, to me, that's artwork that's encased, you know, that's graded. I like to buy them graded, but even raw, I think that's cool too, to have raw copies. So, and they all carry their own value. You know, so I don't think there's any right or wrong to it necessarily. And so, you know, it's all about having fun, guys. What do you think? Tell me your thoughts. If you haven't already, please subscribe. We've got over 100 videos at this point, and we're going to keep on going. We are hitting more broad topics. I spend a lot of time on sports card investing because it's a passion of mine. But we also, you know, are going to get into, you know, comic book investing and some of the other collectibles that are out there. You know, who knows? Maybe I'll do an episode on Beanie Babies for all those that want to see it. Give me some topic ideas as well in the comments, because I'm interested in all this stuff. I'm interested in researching all the different avenues for this. And so I'm happy to take suggestions as far as topics go for new videos, for what you want to see, and we'll go from there. But hey, thanks for joining, guys. We will talk to you again soon.